Hi, everybody. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Lunch and Learn. Thrilled to have you here on this cold day. Before we start, there are two people that I want to introduce you to, one of whom is the guest of honor. Well, actually, both of whom are the guests of honor, but one is the guest of honor for this concert, which is our principal horn, Paul Clifton. Here's Paul. And we'll get to Paul, back to Paul in just a second, but first we have another very exciting announcement, and that is that the West Michigan Symphony's new executive director is in the house, Andy Bilo. And Andy begins officially next week, so he's here unofficially, but you're still allowed to talk to him. So Paul, it's interesting, you know, we have more musicians than I can think of in any other orchestra that I've recently worked with that used to play with the orchestra and then moved away, moved far away, and still play with the orchestra. For example, our principal clarinetist, John Holden, who moved to Tallahassee, Florida, is a great example. Our English horn player, Phil Popham, who moved to Los Angeles and still plays with us. Quite amazing. Our tuba player, Clint, moved to Louisville and still plays with us because they sense the wonderful spirit and the excitement going on here and the feeling that this orchestra is really going places. This year, Paul is on a leave of absence for this year. We expect him back, yeah? And so we've brought him back a little early to be a soloist. And it's been a very long time since we've had a French horn soloist. In fact, I can't remember the last time that we had one, so it must have been before I got here. So that's a while ago. So I'm sure you have many burning questions about the French horn, and I'm thinking that we can start by having Paul explain a little bit about himself and the instrument as well.
Sure. Yeah. Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. So I, as Scott was saying, have moved to Arizona to be with my wife. We were married last summer. She moved down last year, actually, to begin a job teaching high school band. And so we were married, and then I moved down in July. And wow, there aren't as many orchestras there as there are here, that's for sure. I have missed this, playing professionally here a lot. So I moved down to Rio Rico is where she is. I don't know if anyone happens to know where that is, but it's an hour south of Tucson, very close to the border with Mexico, actually. And it's a really, really nice place, but I'm also glad to be back here as I was making my drive. I grew up in the east side of Michigan in Howell, and so I was there for the holidays with my parents and my family, and making the drive last night, I was like, I know all these places, Grand Rapids, places that I haven't seen in a long time either. 6 months or so is definitely the longest I've been away from Michigan before, but it is very good to be back.
Let me just interrupt to say that, you know, very often when a player goes somewhere else where there are a lot fewer playing opportunities, as we're talking about in Arizona, you worry that they might get out of shape. So the way that we solved that was gave them a concerto.
That's funny. While I was there, actually, to make it even doubly challenging, as well as not having as many playing opportunities, from October through December, I was a long-term substitute for a middle school band director who had a baby at the end of October, and so she went on maternity leave, and I was her sub for their second quarter of school, and my God, are middle schoolers tiring, or what? Wow. God. Wow, that was the hardest thing I think I've ever had to do in my life so far, was be a middle school band director for 3 months.
That wow. I have new respect for you, Paul.
Well, I tell you what, I have so much more respect now for working with adults instead of kids. I'm serious. I did not understand how easy it was coming to this orchestra and any other orchestra in this area and working with people who are completely prepared at the first rehearsal and who come with good attitudes and who don't talk when they're not supposed to. Oh my God. Oh.
So
awful. Middle schoolers are awful about talking.
So Paul, now we know a little bit about you. Let's find out about this instrument, because it's one of the most fascinating instruments and has one of the strangest evolutions, I think, of orchestral instruments. Maybe you can tell us about how the French horn started and how it got to where it is now.
Mm-hmm. The horn started as nothing like this at all. What you see here is all brass, shaped very, very finely. Many curves that have to be very exact to produce the cracked pitches. You'll see 6 slides here on the front, 2 on the back. It all amounts to 17 or 18 feet of tubing if you stretched it out. So this is the modern double horn, it's called. There's a thumb valve that you'll see me use, and that allows me to access each set of the slides on the front. But to go back before this, the horn started out as either a ram's horn or a conch shell that were used, and holes were cut into the tips, and they were used as signal instruments for military purposes, for hunting purposes, for ceremonial purposes. I have a conch shell in Arizona. I wish I would have brought it. Darn. Right. But so obviously a conch shell or a ram's horn is extremely different from this. But it's interesting, though, that even with the limited size, maybe, I don't know, 6 or 8 inches or so of a ram's horn, or the way a conch shell looks and is shaped, you can still produce multiple pitches, which is similar to the modern horn. Before this instrument, there was something called the natural horn, which is, if you take all of the slides out in the middle, if you take all of these valve pads out, so there are no buttons on the natural horn. All it is it consists of the mouthpiece, and the lead pipe is where we put the mouthpiece into, and it comes around for about one big loop, and then there's another small loop in which you can put different slides, one at a time, though, to put the horn in different keys, basically, and then it would come out to the bell. So it was much simpler instrument, also more rudimentary, though, but it couldn't produce as many pitches as...
Can I interrupt? So, sure. So with a natural horn, sort of like with a bugle, you have to do all of the changes of pitch with your lips. Mm-hmm. And maybe you can show, without the horn, how you would change pitch with your lips.
Yeah.
First without the horn, and then with maybe just with the horn.
Oh, you mean free?
Just show what your lips do.
Oh. Yeah. So the lips in the air combine to make the sound. The lips. I always compare it when I talk to students, like someone with a hose, and the water coming out of the hose is the lips. And the water coming out is the air. And so, you know, when you close your thumb over the opening of the hose, it decreases the space that water has to come out and increases the pressure, which is similar to our lips. When we go higher, our lips tighten up a little bit and get smaller, and thus the air is sped up. And then when we go lower, our lips, my lips open up and the air slows down a little bit, just like the water put in the hose. I hope that makes sense. So there's something called free buzzing that I can do, and you can maybe see a little bit of what my lips do. Yes, I'm far away from you, but the general opening up as I go lower, tightening up as I go higher, and the air speeding up or slowing down.
Now, you probably know that that's an overtone series, yeah? So that's from the fundamental. Those are all the overtones that would be heard from that fundamental note if you were to listen really carefully. And so a horn in a given key can only play the overtone series of that key. And this is where it gets really interesting, because the valves change all that. You have to use your fingers a lot for that,
yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah.
You know, you might, I think you have something to tell everyone about regarding something you did in between you might not have noticed. You rotated the horn all the way around. What's going on there? Mostly. All right. I just wanted to hear it. Just wanted to point that out. Okay. So now, if you don't mind, we're going to shift gears a little bit, and we're going to talk about this whole concert, which is of which the horn concerto is a huge part. Performances by of pieces by three composers, all of whom went kicking and screaming into their respective centuries. And what I mean by that is, Felix Mendelssohn and his sister Fanny Mendelssohn were extremely conservative for 19th century composers. They were looking back to Bach, they were looking back to Mozart. They lived at the same time that Berlioz was writing his crazy Symphonie Fantastique, or Weber was writing his, you know, extraordinary romantic opera, the Freischütz. But Fanny and Felix Mendelssohn looked very much back to the past and were thinking more 18th century. Or maybe even earlier when they wrote their music. Similarly, Richard Strauss, who wrote the horn concerto that you're going to hear Paul play, believe it or not, lived until 1949. I mean, 1949, The Rite of Spring, the great groundbreaking 20th century work of Igor Stravinsky, was already, what, 36 years old, as well as the 12-tone music of Arnold Schoenberg, not to mention Duke Ellington and all the great jazz that had happened long before 1949. So Richard Strauss, in his music, even though he was seen as a successor to Richard Wagner and was very late romantic, remained for his entire life firmly rooted in the 19th century and sometimes even a little bit before, rather than allowing the modern influences of the 20th century to affect his compositions. So I hadn't thought about it, at least not consciously, when we put these pieces of music together. But it really does make sense that this Germanic classics concert is not just Germanic, but it's extraordinarily, I guess I would say, backward-looking in terms of preserving the glories of the past. So the first piece you're going to hear is by Fanny Mendelssohn. Fanny was the older sister of Felix. She was born 4 years before, in 1805. He was born in 1809. They were from a wealthy family, and they both had all the music training that they could possibly want. In fact, in the case of Felix, when he wrote some string symphonies at the age of 10, his dad hired an orchestra to play it at his house, and he wrote 10 of those, so that must have been quite a chunk of change. Fanny, believe it or not, was actually considered to be the more talented on the piano. And because of the tradition, of course, that women were not to become composers, they were to stay in the house, not only did Fanny become very discouraged from being a full-time professional composer, but she also passed off some of her own works as her brother's, in her brother's name. So there are some pieces that are listed as Felix Mendelssohn that Fanny actually wrote. Quite amazing. She did manage, however, to have a very thriving, let's say, musical home life. So she'd have lots of salons at her house. Later on, she took over a family home in Berlin, and they were an all of Europe, it was said, would come to their house for the evenings of great music making. Fanny on the piano being fantastic, playing partly music that she had written. So we're starting this concert with an overture of Fanny Mendelssohn that I bet has never been played in Michigan before, and I'm sure has never been played by this orchestra before. It's called the Overture in C. I thought maybe we'd listen to just the very beginning of it. There's a slow introduction, which might remind you of the slow introduction of a Mozart or Beethoven symphony. Let's listen. So that's the idea of the beginning. And then after that slow introduction, there is a fast and furious and very, very cheerful C major overture. when you listen to that, and when I listen to this music, I'm thinking this could easily be Felix Mendelssohn, right? It's so much the similar, very similar style, and of course they were brother and sister and grew up in the same house and had exactly the same influences. By the way, Fanny Mendelssohn's piano teachers, forte pianos teachers, harpsichord teacher was Johann Sebastian Bach. So, yeah, so there is a direct line there, and in fact, Bach has a huge influence in both Mendelssohn's outputs. I'll tell you later regarding Felix, but it's largely Felix Mendelssohn who's responsible for our even being aware of Johann Sebastian Bach. Quite amazing. So after this overture, which I won't talk about too much because it's not very long, but it's very, again, very cheerful and triumphant, then we play the Strauss horn concerto. And I don't know if you want to talk about this, Paul, I'd be glad to, about Richard Strauss and his father. Is there anything you'd like to say about that?
Well, he wrote this first concerto. Richard Strauss wrote two of them. One relatively early on in his life, at 19 is when he wrote this concerto. And then I believe he was 78 years old when he wrote his second horn concerto in the early 1940s. Very interesting that they're so far apart, in the same key as well. But his father was alive when he wrote the first one, and he wrote it for his father, actually. And his father, Franz Josef Strauss, was a horn player who played, let me remember, in the Munich Court Opera, and was one of the most highly regarded horn players of his time. But he refused to perform the concerto because he thought it was too difficult. It was really interesting to find that out. I was unaware of that. I played this piece for a while now, and the father, he would only play it at home, never in public. And he the father, Franz, he championed Wagner's operas when they would be premiered. And they're incredibly challenging horn parts in Wagner's operas, but I personally don't know if they're quite as hard as the concerto, or
The concerto is so much more exposed. You're standing right in front of the stage, and mm-hmm. it's all about you.
Yeah.
But, you know, I thought we'd play a little bit of the beginning of the Strauss horn concerto, first movement, because I think it brings out two things that the horn can do really well. The first thing you hear, you know, you think about it, since the natural horn was only capable of playing the overtones of a key, which basically, gross oversimplification, but within a given key, at least the first several overtones are the same notes you would hear if you played the major chord of that key. So, you know, in any key, bum, 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 that's called an arpeggio. Those are the initial overtones that you hear. And so because French horn traditionally was only capable of playing those notes, it's kind of appropriate that the opening riff of the horn, which happens right after the first note that the orchestra plays, is really very much, I think, a commentary on that. It's arpeggios, it's huge arpeggios. But the other thing that the horn is really great at, especially with the valves, is playing very lyrically. And as soon as the orchestra has then played its opening statement, then the horn comes in with something quite lyrical and beautiful. So why don't we hear the first minute or so of the horn concerto.
Thank you.
If someone had told you that's Mozart, wouldn't you believe it? I mean, it's really looking backward. And in fact, Mozart was Strauss's big musical hero, even though he later went on to write things that were extraordinarily complex compared to that, and were harmonically more adventurous. Maybe, Gabe, you can play an example of that. I think we have the beginning of Don Juan, is that right? And Don Juan is also a big horn piece. It's got an enormous horn section solo.
Yeah. If his father thought this concerto was too hard to play in public, Strauss's horn parts only got more challenging, and as he wrote orchestral, his tone poems, if you know that term, Don Juan and Ein Heldenleben and Don Quixote, the horn parts were just, they're extraordinarily fun but difficult at the same time.
So I think this is just to illustrate that this is a composer who was backward-looking, always tonal, for example, never experimented with 12-tone music or really anything quite atonal. Although sometimes it seems like there are two keys going on at once in a couple of his things. But this is now the beginning of Don Juan, and this is the same composer who just wrote that. That piece is challenging enough that it is the audition, it's on the audition list for every string instrument and many brass instruments and many woodwind instruments. And that's Strauss at his probably most out there romantically, but it was also written early. It was also an early piece in which Strauss was asserting himself and saying, look what I can do as a composer. But again, his heart was with the masters of the past. And even that was music that could have been written quite a bit earlier in the history of music than it was. Let's see, do we have, Gabe, we have the other movements of the Strauss? Maybe we can go to the third movement. Can you tell us just a bit about your challenges in the third movement of the Strauss?
The third movement is much lighter and faster than the previous two. Much more articulation. You heard a fair amount of slurs in legato playing in the little bit of the first movement, and there's more of that in the second movement. But in the third movement, it's much more articulated. The leaps come a lot faster. That's mostly tempo and articulation that make it more challenging than the previous movements.
Is there anything you want to demonstrate? Or? Should we just play it?
Well, I guess I will.
And then the orchestra does the same thing. And again, it's a horn call, right? It's a hunting horn call, it sounds like. Let's hear it with orchestra as well.
Thank you.
So you have both the heroic and the lighthearted and the hunting call and the lyrical and the passionate and the sweet. All of that can be provided by the horn. And, you know, very often in so much music, stereotypically, it's when they want heroics that they have the horn come in. So often. It's very rare that a composer brings in the horn when he wants sentimental, for example. I'm thinking of Tchaikovsky's Fifth Symphony, second movement, has a gorgeous horn solo like that. And this, too, brings every emotion out of the French horn and really shows what it can do.
Yeah, that makes me think about when I was asked to play the concerto in December, 2 years ago now. And the suggestion was this Strauss concerto or a Mozart concerto. And although Mozart is even more commonly played by the horn than Strauss, Strauss and Mozart are the most, their horn concertos are it, if you will, for horn players, as you both as a student and as a professional. And when I thought about playing the Mozart compared to the Strauss, I thought that I would do the Strauss instead because there's a wider range both of inflection, of dynamic and intensity, and as a result of emotion that can be brought out. Mozart is more, well, naturally more conservative and it's more, I guess you could call it limited in its scope of dynamic and of range and of the colorful notes. And I have to say too that for Mozart, he was limited to the natural horn. He only had so many notes that he could write and have it sound good, whereas Strauss then had access to the valved horn, so he had a lot more flexibility in that way. But I wanted to play the Strauss because of the energy that can be brought by it and the many, many shades, the palette, if you will, is much broader.
I'm really glad you decided to play the Strauss. It's wonderful and great. And like I said, a first for our orchestra, certainly. At least in my time, we've never played this. And that goes for the third piece on the program as well, Felix Mendelssohn's First Symphony. Now that's a bit of a misnomer because Mendelssohn, although he wrote five named or numbered symphonies, he also wrote before that 10 string symphonies beginning around the age of 10. Mendelssohn was a huge prodigy, more so than Mozart. People don't realize that because unlike Mozart's father, Leopold, who trumpeted Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart's abilities to anyone that would hear and wanted to tour all over Europe and so on, Mendelssohn's father was not that way at all. He didn't want to promote his son's talent. But no less, well, I don't know if it's an authority, but no less a figure than Goethe, the philosopher, who knew the family and had heard both Mozart as a kid and Mendelssohn as a kid, said that Mendelssohn was much more talented in his younger years than Mozart was. Now, I bow down before Mozart, but I think that his most sublime works came sometime after the age of 10, you know? And in the case of Mendelssohn, he wrote his great overture to Midsummer Night's Dream when he was 16 years old, and just incredible. And the First Symphony, which is in C minor, but then later goes into C major, was written when he was 15 years old. So here you have someone in the midst of their teen years who I'm sure is, again, looking to the old masters and wanting to create something with equal seriousness and thinking at the age of 15, I can do something that's just as serious, has just as much drama as say, Beethoven. And what you get, the result that you get, is the First Symphony, which is so intensely, quite intense for him, I would say, and has such a seriousness of purpose, but at the same time you wonder, is he really feeling this, or is he just trying to do or somehow emulate what he'd seen other composers do? I'll let you be the judge of that, but let's listen to the beginning of the first movement of Mendelssohn's First Symphony, which is unrelentingly serious, and see what you think. and so on. I mean, it just goes, and it's so much of it is written forte or fortissimo, and then another fortissimo, and an accent fortissimo, almost as if to say, you know, by writing these loud dynamics, I can achieve this level of drama and seriousness. Now, did he actually have that in him? Very possibly. I mean, he was a genius. But when you hear the drama of his later works, his later symphonies, his oratorios, Elijah, for example, it feels maybe a little bit less forced. It's just as powerful, but it comes maybe less relentlessly. So it's interesting, very interesting to me, to play this early work of Mendelssohn, which is obviously supremely crafted and has an incredible fugue, for example, in the last movement. That he had all of the skill, and he knew what he was trying to emulate. And then the question is, how much of that did he actually feel within him? Speaking of fugues, he was, as I alluded to earlier, the one who brought about a new recognition of the greatness of Johann Sebastian Bach. He was the first person in, quote, modern times, that is, since the death of Bach, another 100 years or so had passed, and he was the first person to perform the St. Matthew Passion. And he did this in Leipzig. And he joked, because he came from a Jewish family, and he said, it's crazy that it took a Jew to bring to the world the greatest piece of Christian music ever. But it's really quite amazing that since then, there was a renaissance in love of and interest in the work of Bach. And if there's one composer who looks to Bach for inspiration, it's Mendelssohn. And you hear this all the way throughout the symphony, and especially, as I mentioned, in the last movement. I think we are going to just have time for a few questions now, so we won't play more music. Thank you, Gabe, up there for providing it for us. But let's see if you have any questions either about the music or maybe more interestingly about Paul or the horn.
Her question, if anyone didn't hear, is, in Arizona, is the condensation issue inside the horn any different, any greater, any less than it is here in Michigan? And I think actually it's less, because the air there is a little bit drier, and so it doesn't condense quite as much. There's not as much moisture in the air as there is here. So I do have to work a little bit harder in Michigan than I do in Arizona to make sure that the water gets out. Yeah, good question.
Also, I would think that outdoors, if you're playing outdoors, since it's warmer outside, mm-hmm. there might not be any condensation, well, in theory, right?
Yeah. Sometimes when it's warmer, the condensation is less an issue. But then if it's colder, like even now, it's colder almost everywhere, then the condensation issue does become a greater one.
But that would be a very good way. What you should do is play the horn in an environment where it's 98.6 degrees outside, and see if you still get condensation, then it's definitely spit. Which is my contention. Yes.
Why the French horn? Oh, gosh. It's not from France. It was not invented by a French person. The term French was probably ascribed to it because it maybe came to the United States literally from a port in France to a port in the United States. But the history of the horn is definitely English and German. The hunting traditions and in mostly England, and then the valves were added on by German musicians, German horn players. So if anything, it should be the English German horn, but so actually, to add to that, there is an International Horn Society, a governing body of horn players. They have a president and they have a treasurer and whatnot, and they have symposiums that happen each year. And I think it was 1973 that they officially changed the name to horn, not French horn. They took the French out of it because it doesn't do it justice. So technically it is just the horn, as I think I see now more often on orchestras' websites, for instance, where they say horn and then they list the players instead of French horn. So slowly the change is being made, but it is not French at all. Nope.
And neither is the English horn English, by the way. The word cor anglais, which was the French word for it, anglais now means English, but back then it meant angled. It was an angled horn because it had this angle to the mouthpiece. So there you go. So if you want to call yours the English horn, you could, actually. All right. Other questions? Yeah.
How long have you been playing and why did you pick the horn?
I have been playing the horn since sixth grade, which I think is 15 years now. Gosh, that's over half my life. Wow. wow. And the reason I picked the horn, I don't know if I'll ever have a good answer for that, honestly, because I don't remember having a strong reaction to it. When I do remember instrument picking day, I tried the tuba and I couldn't get a sound out of it. This was in the band room in sixth grade, right when the school year started. I think I tried the alto saxophone as well. I don't even remember if I tried out the horn, but my parents both went to college for music education. They both played brass instruments, my mom the horn, my dad the trumpet. And so my brother and I both, we would pick up their mouthpieces once. My brother plays the bass trombone in this very orchestra, actually. And so he would pick up the trombone mouthpiece and play on it once in a while when we were still in our diapers. And I don't remember picking up the horn mouthpiece and buzzing on it or whatnot, but I did pick the horn, and I had an upbringing with piano and with singing, and because of the way the horn works with all those notes you can play on any one fingering, you need to have a very good ear to translate what's on the page, to hear it first before you play it so that you can be very accurate. Otherwise, there are a whole bunch of notes that you can hit that aren't the right one. So perhaps my band director, because he knew my parents, my dad actually worked with him as an assistant band director, knew that and sort of pushed me toward the horn. So it was a good choice, ultimately.
Can I just pick up on that? Because it's really amazing, because when Paul was demonstrating all the notes that could be played with a natural horn, the entire overtone series, and that was only with the lips, going all the way up and all the way down, and to think that in a given piece of music, you have to pick out one of those, which means you have to know, you have to sort of have this feel exactly how tight your lips have to be, and if it's just a little bit too tight or too loose, it's going to be a different note. Amazing.
The way I describe it to students is playing the horn is like being an archer, but the archery range, the targets are all back to back. They're all in one line going out instead of one line, I guess, horizontally. They're vertical. And so you have to know all of them, and you have to know for whatever you're playing which one to aim for, which ones to aim over, and which ones to not go too far and hit. You have to pick the right one in that line of targets. You really, yeah, that's how it is. You can't necessarily see them all as easily. Like on a piano, for instance, you would definitely have the targets out in a horizontal way. You can see all of the notes, but for the horn, it's very different, where you have to know very carefully just where to aim and where to fire that arrow with the right speed and whatnot. I hope that makes sense a little bit. Yeah.
Amazing. Any other questions? I see one over there, yeah. Like, you mean like Richard Strauss would do. Richard Strauss was a notoriously lazy conductor, I guess, even though he was an incredibly meticulous composer. He would conduct just as that was described, sitting down with the thumb in the waistcoat pocket. He wanted to get to, interestingly, there is a very famous German card game, which is called Scott. It's spelled S-K-A-T, Scott. And that was his favorite thing to do, was to play Scott. So he would want to get through the concert and would sometimes take out his pocket watch and see what time it was and start conducting faster. But no, I won't be doing that.
Please don't do that on Friday.
Right. Paul gets to set the tempos on Friday. Maybe one more question, yeah.
Right.
Well, that's a really good question, isn't it? I mean, I guess we'll never know. But certainly the ones that that we know of, which were, was an early set of songs, those are now credited to her. But it's, who knows, you know, maybe she wrote the Italian Symphony. I kind of doubt it, but it's, you know, but it's possible. There was, as you know, of course, the prejudice against women doing anything like that back then would have made it impossible under her name to have published something really grand and serious, and so that was her way of getting around it. Yeah, it's a really interesting concert. I mean, the more, sometimes the more you talk about it, the more you realize how everything fits together, and having all these composers, or these three composers, all of whom looked backwards and yet were incredibly talented for their time and among the greatest composers who ever lived. Putting that all together in one concert to me is fascinating, and I think it'll also be beautiful. So thank you, everyone. Hope to see you Friday, and thank you to Paul Clifton.